go back to verse 20. Look, listen to me. This is what I have learned. And all of you know that I'm studying the book of Romans at the same pace as you. I've never studied it before. I'm not ahead of you. I'm with you. Right? We've been walking through this together for the past 4 months. This is what I was taught. I was taught that we live under grace, that there's no law, that the law doesn't apply, that we live under grace and we just have faith. What were you taught? What? There's no right or wrong answer. What I'm doing is I'm assessing what you guys believe and gals so that we can all get on the same page. We've gone through 5 chapters. We have to stop and now talk this through. I was taught that the law, that it was for the Jews. I was taught that I didn't have to live any laws. I was taught that I can just do whatever and that I'm covered through grace. That no matter what I do, that there's grace. What were you guys taught? Okay, that's true. If you repent, the Bible says God is faithful to forgive. Sister Chantel. Praise God. Fair enough. We have repentance of sin. We have, that's essentially rebellion. That's what that's called. Sis? Yes, ma'am. Listen, there's no right or wrong answer. Like, I mean, the Bible's right. But for tonight, we all have to listen to what everybody's saying. And then we're going to go into the text as we go forward. Anybody else? It's essentially what Sister Chantel said. And tell me your name one more time, sis. Yes. Mary and Sister Marielle. The continued sin is rebellion. Right? Anyone else? Fair enough. We're going to press on. Go ahead. Right. Right. So, I want to talk about this, and I want to be transparent with the church. Go ahead, sis. which is called legalism, right? Legalism is that you are doing these things, these commandments, that you're doing them to be saved, right? You cannot work for salvation. You understand, like, the Bible makes it clear that it's a free gift, right? And we're even reading right here that the offense came through Adam, but the free gift came through Jesus. It's a free gift. Jesus performed the hard part. Jesus fulfilled this law. He even said, I did not come to abolish the law. Abolish the law is what I was taught. That Jesus came and he's like, yo, guys, law is done. We can just party now. It's all good. That's what I was taught. When I tell you that's what I was taught, I'm talking about till 6 months ago. This study has impacted my entire theology to where I have finally started over, and now I know that I'm making progress, okay? This is what the Bible says, and we're going to go through it, and this is what I wanted to say, that I wanted to be transparent. I always tell you to read the Bible for yourself. Do not take my word for it. You have to put in your own work, okay? Two people left this church because of what the Lord is showing me. I know that this is the Lord. I know, Brian Mohika, I know that God showed me this. One person left and said, you are teaching legalism, which means you have to keep the law to be saved. That person on the way out that said, you cannot teach the law and grace at the same time. And after they left, I go, oh my God, that's exactly what it is. It's the law and grace at the same exact time. That's what Jesus came to do. The other person that left the church said that I'm teaching a false doctrine. I'm okay with that. I anticipated that happening. It happens in all ministries. There's always disagreements. But you have to study this for yourself. Amen? I want to make that clear. So now I'm going to get into what everybody said. This is what the Bible says, okay? Jesus fulfilled the law, right? Jesus fulfilled the law. This is the standard. I cannot make my own standard. I cannot say that this is my law. I cannot live in the kingdom of God and say, God, I know you have your law. Thank you. But this is how I want to show you love. If you love God, that's why Jesus says it over and over in the New Testament. If you love me, not do it. It says, if you love me, keep my commandments. 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 The problem is that when you hear that word law in a Christian setting, people automatically shut their brain off. But that's why you have 30,000 denominations in Christianity. Because there are 100 different rulers from this standard. God only has one standard. When we stand in the presence of God, he's not looking at Charlie like this. And then, because he's having a bad day, he's looking at Brother Leonard like this. He is a judge. He is a police officer. You understand? There's one standard. It's like a military unit. A military unit has one rule, one code, one mind. Sister, you have your hand up? Great. Very true. It is. It is. And here's the thing. Whatever it is that you know, it has to fit in the Bible completely. So sometimes people take in Galatians where it says we're not under law anymore. But in the book of Romans, we're seeing that Paul says that the law is good. So how can Paul say in the book of Romans that the law is good, that we're going to get into it tonight, and then in the book of Galatians, he says we're not under law? The Bible does not contradict itself. So whatever you believe, it has to fit. It has to be whole in Scripture, right? If it doesn't, then that means that we need to dig a little more, okay? In the book of Galatians, the reason why Paul wrote that epistle to the church of Galatia, they were trying to be circumcised. They were trying to circumcise their penis because they thought that they had to do that in order to be saved. What did we hear? What did we read a couple of weeks ago in Romans chapter 4? That there's no circumcision. There's the circumcision or there's no circumcision. The new circumcision is of the heart, right? Which is what Sister T said, that that's what the Holy Spirit is for. What does the new covenant say in Ezekiel? It says, I will give them my spirit and I will write my law into their hearts. How can we then say that the law is gone when the purpose of the Holy Spirit is to not give you stone tablets now, it's to write it into your heart? Bingo. It's so simple that I don't know what the fight, at least with me. I say it over and over. I sit every week with a teacher one-on-one for the past year and a half reviewing this. And I've been arguing with this teacher like, nope, nope, nope. And you know what I realized? I was arguing with the Holy Spirit. Because every verse that I brought, I'm like, nope, look right here. Paul says that we're not under law. See, you're wrong. You're wrong. And he said, read it in its entirety. So I go, well, wait a minute. And then I would read Galatians in its entirety, and it's talking about circumcision. It's talking about justification. All right? This is God. Jesus Christ died on the cross so that he could fulfill the law. We could be righteous through him. We can have grace, which is God saying, yo, I know that you're going to fail. And when you fail, like Sister Chantel said, you answered it perfectly, I'm going to show you grace. So we do. We have grace to follow these commandments. And when you fail, God says, I already knew that you were going to fail, but my grace is sufficient to sustain you. I already knew that you were going to fail, but my grace is abundant. But it's not so that you can just throw the law away and be like, well, I don't got to do anything then, because God is gracious. That's not what the Bible says. It's not. That's what I thought, but it's not what the Bible says. Let's continue to dig deeper. Any questions? Why would God give us grace if we're not supposed to follow anything? So I was debating with my teacher, and this is when I knew that I was on a crash course with the Holy Spirit, because everything that I presented, the teacher was able to show me that it was out of context. And everything that I was saying, it couldn't fit. So I kept saying, man, everything that I'm being taught, that I was taught, like, it's true, it doesn't fit. Romans 3:31, somebody please read that to me. Do we nullify the law? Romans is up there. Okay. Do we then make void the law through faith? This is what I was taught. I was taught that if you have faith, that you don't have to keep the law. That our new relationship with God is through faith. If that's true, it's not. But if that's true, Paul would be making another law on top of what Jesus said. That's why Paul is so misunderstood in his epistles. That's why a lot of the Jewish people, they say Paul has his own religion and Jesus has his own religion. And they don't. Paul is not speaking from his own mind. He's speaking, Paul, every time he speaks from the standard of God. Paul does not say anything on his own. So that's why right here, I saw you, Brother Sergio, give me a second. That's why right here it says, Do we then make void the law through faith? So the sister was saying that Jesus said, love God and love your neighbor. But those two laws, it's like saying, this is a building. Like our church is in a building. Yeah, but we're in suite 325 and there's suite 324 and there's suite 323, but we're in a building. Jesus was just summarizing it. How do you know? Here's how I know, which you guys that have been here every week and hear me preach. Jesus said, love God, right? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, strength. What if my way of loving God is sleeping with as many married women as I want? Who's to say that I'm wrong? Huh? Exactly. You see what I'm saying? You need this. When we look at our brothers and sisters, remember that the Bible, the Apostle Paul said that without the law, we wouldn't even know what sin is. That's why in the church, we're like, that's not a sin. That's not a sin. That's why you got drag queens behind the pulpit, because love is love. This is what love is love is. Love is somebody making their own standard and saying that it's in scripture. But what do the commandments say? That man on man is an abomination. But that's a commandment. So if you don't follow the law, which is made up of the commandments, then what you've done is, because we live under faith, because we live under grace, what you've done is you've made your own standard. God is not changing who he is because we are not able to understand what the word says or because what we were taught. Paul goes on, you almost have to read all five chapters to truly enjoy what he's saying there. He's saying, do we then make void the law through faith? That's all I've heard. No, you got faith. I just thought, yeah, I believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross for my sins. That's my faith. I'm good. But according to scripture, I'm not. Because it says, do we then make void the law through faith? Not only does he say no, that's not true, but he says, certainly no. One. And then he says, on the contrary, bam! We established the law. Like, that's when I read that, that's what I think. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's what I hear. We're all Hispanic in here, except for Brother Chris, but he's almost Hispanic. We've all slapped our hands on the table when we've been upset. You know what I'm saying? We've all been like, yo, aquí en esta casa te manda aquí, soy yo. You know what I mean? Something stupid like that. That's what that's saying. Like, he's saying, do we then make void the law through faith? Certainly not. Actually, we established the law. How can we say that the law is bad? The largest psalm in the Bible is Psalm 119. All of Psalm 119 are the psalmists saying how wonderful and how good the law is. How can us as Christians say it's not that good because I'm not under it? You understand? The law, King David said, your law is a lamp unto my feet. The law of God is it's how we know how to walk. And when you fall, we have grace to get back. That's the job of the Holy Spirit. What's the job of the Holy Spirit? To speak in tongues? What's the job of the Holy Spirit? So that you can tell if your neighbor's talking about you? The job of the Holy Spirit is we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. That's how we're strengthened, so that we can walk this out. The Bible says, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. It's not that you have to work for it. It's that your faith is supposed to say that you believe. How do I know that you believe? Remember, God gave the law. That's why the Hebrews, they stood out in the pagan culture. They blended in with all these people. How did they know? Don't you see that people know that you're a believer? How do they know? Because if you're a woman and you used to dress provocative before,
and you know that that's unholy, but now you come into the presence of God and you be like, yo, look at so-and-so. I remember she used to dress like whatever, and now, like, wow, like she's glowing. Why? Because now you're trying to live holy. So that change is a holiness. The reason why God gave us a standard is the standard is good. It's to make us holy. How can you become like Jesus Christ? If Jesus Christ fulfilled the law and we're supposed to be like Christ, how can you be like Christ and not fulfill the law? How? By coming to church and throwing a couple of dollars in the change bin? How? By going to the park and handing out some cheeseburgers? Jesus fulfilled the law. So now, out of favor for him, we do it. Out of our love for him, we do it. Out of our admiration, when you say that you have faith in God, that's how it's shown. It's shown through your works. And James 2 is the best place that I found to explain it. If you're writing it down, read James 2. It says, faith without works is dead. What is that works if it's not the law? What is it? Because if it is, and I say, well, you helped the guy on the corner, I don't think that's what it is, you're screwed. Because now you got to do something else, and you got to do something else, and you got to do something else. But if we have a standard and we know what they are, then we know. Oh, well, it says, well, love your neighbor. What if my version of loving you is every time I see you, I slap you in the face? How do you know? Not to me. You see what I'm saying? I'm exaggerating to make a point. You see how it falls in line? Somebody said, oh, in Romans 13, it says that the love is the fulfillment of the law. But the love of God is the law. When the Apostle Paul says in the book of Corinthians, if you don't have love, you don't have anything. That's not a random love. Paul, remember, there's people in this community who tell people that I know that we don't need the Old Testament. But you got to remember that the New Testament didn't exist. When Paul is writing this epistle to the church of Rome, he's writing it from the Old Testament. And he's telling them about love and about sin. And because Paul knows the standard, Paul was a Pharisee. Paul was taught, and you had a question, I didn't go back to you. Go ahead. Yeah. Right, but he never, and you're right, it was different letters to different people, but he never spoke on his own intelligence. Right? Like when Eunice and I, and you should as well, when you counsel people, if your counseling of that person doesn't start with the Bible says, you've led them astray. So when people sit down with me, they're like, yo, we need to talk. I always tell them, what I'm going to tell you is in the Bible. Because if I don't, then I'm giving them my own standard. Well, this is what I think you should do. No. You're the pastor. Don't tell me what you think I should do. Tell me what the Bible says, and I'll take it from there. So then what I do as a pastor is to give you the standard of God. This is what God says that you should do in your situation. And it's for you to take it or leave it. There's a standard. So when Paul is writing these letters, right, when he says the verse that we all throw at each other as Christians, if you don't have love, you don't have nothing. But that love, it's not subjective. It's not a Paul love. It's an agape love. It's a standard love. It's an, it's a, Old Testament love. It's a law of God love. So when he says, if you don't have love, you don't have anything. Sometimes people say that, but it's used out of context. You get what I'm saying? It's not what I think love is. If you're loving me according to the standard of God, and I go, well, that's not love. You know that it is because you know you're using the standard. Does that make sense? Nothing that Paul says is on his own, but that's what I thought that it was. And if that's true, that he's doing things on his own, then he's going against Jesus and he's going against the Torah. Pharisees, which Paul was, he was a student of the Torah, sis. Mm-hmm. That don't know, right? What is he gonna teach us? What he believes? No, all right? So now, back to 521, Rafa, and then we're gonna go with the definition soon of antinomianism. All right, let's go back to 21. No, verse 20, sorry, 5, verse 20. So look at what it says. Look at what Paul says. Moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound. So that means the reason why the law was even introduced is so that everybody knew what they were doing. You get what I'm saying? If you don't know that you're speeding, you'll never know that you're speeding until you look at what in your car? The speedometer. Until you look at a sign. So what that means... Huh? So, or you won't know, like, you know, when you go, if you've ever driven in Europe, like, the signs over there are different. It's in kilometers, or you go to Canada. Like, you need that to know. That's the standard in that country. So I need to drive according to that standard, right? So look at what it says. Moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound. So there's a whole bunch of sin in the room. Nobody knows what sin. All of a sudden, God comes, boom, and establishes the law. And we're all like, whoa. But then Paul says, but where sin abounded, grace abounded much more. So Paul is saying, it doesn't matter how much sin is in the room. God just wanted to show you his law so that you can know what your sin is. And now Paul is introducing what is called grace so that you can get out of that sin, not so you can stay in that sin. I found this definition yesterday through my research, and I am like excited, and I'm keeping my composure, believe it or not. This is unbelievable. Let's go with antinomianism. So here's a definition. What we were taught, I'll say me, so that way I'm not attacking anybody. What I was taught is that we live under grace, that's it, that I don't have to follow the law, that I'm under grace, and there's just grace, and there's grace, and that's it. And we're under grace, and that's what Jesus did. There's no law. The law doesn't apply to Brian Mohika. And I believe a lot of people in this room were taught the same thing. That term is called antinomianism. Anti, like against, and then nomo in the middle is... It means the law. That word, it's an actual doctrine. This is what's in the church right now. This is why the church is so misaligned. The church of God is not supposed to be misaligned. You should be able to go to one church and another church. And if you're living the same standard, everybody should be doing the same thing. So it says that it's a theology, right? The belief that Christians, by virtue of divine grace, which is what Paul is talking about in 5:20, He said that where sin is abundant, grace abounds. So it says by virtue of divine grace that we are freed not only from the biblical law and church prescribed behavioral norms, but also from the moral law. Is that, if you believe that, can you just raise your hand if this is what you believe? Okay, just me. Good. Okay, good. Good. What is it that you don't understand? I know. It's okay. That's okay. That's what we're here for. And if you guys don't talk, we're going to lose the study. She went first and then I'll go to you. Sorry. We're not. Right. That's one thing I want to make clear. You said that Jesus Christ died on the cross, so we're not automatically saved. We are saved because Jesus Christ died on the cross. There's nothing that you can do for that because he is righteous, right? What I was taught, Brother Richie, is that what Chantel just said, that I'm good now. If I want to cheat on my wife, if I want to smoke, drink, steal, murder, I'm good. People go back and forth with that. I don't believe that. It's that once you're saved, you don't even do half the stuff that you did anyway, so you won't even lose your salvation. But go ahead. The Holy Spirit convicts you of what? Of breaking the law. Exactly. And here's the thing. It's like salt and pepper. What I thought it was one or the other. I thought it was that I was only saved and I didn't have to do anything, or it was that I have to work, which I'm wasting my time. It's not. It's both. You are saved, and the way that you show God that you love him for what he did is that you live. If to live in his kingdom is to live under his rules. You cannot live in the kingdom and take your shoes off and do whatever you want. When the book of Ecclesiastes says, when you walk into the presence of God, do not come into the presence with foolish talk and keep your cool. Correct. Correct. Because it's a two-way street. You're saved by grace through faith, but that word faith, it's faith in what? It's not faith that you're saved. It's faith in the law that you're gonna, that Jesus, you see what I'm saying? It's that faith. It's a saving faith. When people say in the church, you just gotta be obedient. You just gotta be obedient. Obedient to what? Obedient to the law. Brother Richie, does that help? Okay, check this out. Forget about Richie. You lying in church. Look. Forget about the word. This guy was just texting and threw his phone across the church. look it, my brother, because I'm learning it too. Forget about the name, Brother Richie. There's a belief in the church, right? That because we have grace, that we're free from any law. That we don't have to do anything. That's not true. That's why Paul says, do we abolish the law through faith? Certainly not. Right? Sis, go ahead.
That's okay.
Mm-hmm. 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 Yeah, they had to sacrifice. Okay, so not all 613 laws are they even gonna be applicable. Sometimes we just point to them and we say, oh, I have to do all of that, but they might not all be applicable. But here's what it is. Just because you cannot keep it, according to scripture, it doesn't mean that you should not make an attempt. That's grace. God is giving you grace to try, but it's not to, I'm telling you right now, it's not in scripture. I don't care what anybody says. Brother Leonard is a student. Everyone, Rafa, everyone, nobody, it's not in here. It's not in here. I stand on that. You have to stand on it, but I stand on it because I'm here. So when Paul says something, right? I'm pointing because I talk with my hands. But when Paul says something that seems contrary, we have to stop and look at the text, because if that's true, that he said that we don't have to keep the law, then he's cutting his own. You see what I'm saying? He's cutting his own letter somewhere else. So then that's the next part that I was going to say. When it comes to being saved, that's why you have to really, not you, but you're new. I don't want to keep pointing at you. But anytime you read in the Bible that says you have to keep the law, if you take a little verse, pop, and you pop it out and you're like, look, Pastor Brian was wrong. Look, it says you got to keep the law. You're going to be right. But if you take that back and it has to fit. So that's what I was doing to my teacher. I was taking one verse and I was saying, oh, look, but it has to fit in context. The majority of the time that Paul is saying that you're not supposed to follow the law is for justification. And you're not, because you can't. Does that make sense? It's a balance. It's a balance. It's salt and pepper. It's salt and pepper. Jesus saved me, and now I'm going to try to live like him. Jesus saved me, and now I'm going to try to live like him. Jesus is the law, so now I got to try to live the law to the best of my ability. When I fail, there's grace. Jesus gave me grace now to have this relationship with God. Chantel. Okay. Thank you. You're right. And here's the thing. The articles that I read online, now that I know that God has a standard, now that I know that the law is not gone, now that I know that we have grace, now when I read articles, even I have the same Bible as you, now when I read articles, I go to myself like, oh my God, that's wrong. Because we have our brain, you have to understand this, let's take it right from the top. You cannot do anything to be saved. So just take that and just put it down. Just know that you're saved because of Jesus and put that away. Justification and sanctification are two different things. The first day that somebody gives their life to Jesus, they're not like Jesus. Right? I mean, maybe some of you are if you're holy like that. I mean, I smoked cigarettes for a year, my first year that I was saved. So what happens? I'll use me. What happened from when I got saved to right now? That's the sanctification process, is the law. The law is the soap to make you like Christ. How can we say, it doesn't even say it in scripture. It does not say it in scripture that the law is gone. It doesn't say in scripture that the law is bad. And that's a great question. That's what I said. It's such a revelation that I've had that I'm scared. That's why I'm always saying, read this thing for yourself. Because I sat in the seats and I listened to, I'm like, well, he's a pastor and he's saying this, so he must be right. And here's my answer to that. I don't know why there's so much confusion, but I know why there's confusion. Does that make sense? Like, I know why there's confusion, because everybody has their own standard. Everyone, you go to the church down the hall and you got women in long dresses and no makeup, where some of the sisters that are here, according to their standard, you're going to hell. Then you go to another church and everybody's drinking, smoking and drinking 40s and blunts. Now there's a different standard in that church. God did not, you have to understand, Jesus Christ is coming back for one church. It's one body. It's one body. It's one law. Jesus says it over and over and over and over and over in this way, over and over and over in the New Testament. If you love me, keep my commandments. If you love me, keep my commandments. In the book of Revelation, the very last book, it says, those who kept my commandments to the end. It will get to a point. When is there rebellion then? When are you rebellious towards God? It's what Chantel said. When you know what the standard is and you don't do it. Now, if you don't know what the standard is, then God shows you grace. But that, the Apostle Paul says, is grace a license to sin? Let's go to Romans 6, from 1. Who had the hand up? Sorry. Go. Who is the law? It's not. Somebody gives their life to Jesus on Sunday, on Monday morning, they're still wretched. They're still bound. They're still going to smoke blunts the next day, if whatever struggle they have. You get what I'm saying? Now, 5 years later, if that person is still the same, then you could say, but where did you get that from? From the standard. When your children misbehave, don't you have a rule for them in your house? My son is 21, 22 now. I had to kick him out of the house. I mean, I kicked him out of the house, not even really the official kick out. Like, I got him an apartment. I got him fully furnished. Like, I got a U-Haul truck. I was like, yo, bro, it's black TV. Black people are dying. I'm out of here, bro. You know what I'm saying? Bro, I got him a TV. I got him a brand new couch. I got him fork, knives. I got went food shopping. You know why? Because there was a standard in my house. Huh? Yeah, no. Talk to him first before you say that. He couldn't keep the standard in my house. You know what I'm saying? At some point, it was flat out rebellion. So we're so afraid of that word law, because I know there's people in this room that were taught that. And I know that there's people in this room going, I don't know what Brian is saying. Let me tell you something. I feel free from what I was taught. Like, I have a joy. Because I believe that I finally found, after 7.5 years serving the Lord, I finally have my first brick that I can now build on it. Now when I read other parts of scripture, I'm like, he's saying this. Oh, you get what I'm saying? When the Apostle Paul said that women shouldn't have authority over men in the church, where did he get that from? He just made that up? No, he knows that in the Torah, in Genesis, that God said, because Eve, you sinned, your husband is over you. What do we see in the church? Oh no, Paul wrote that because he was speaking to a specific people. But if he was speaking to a specific people, the entire Bible was speaking to a specific people, not people in South Lawrence. So once you say, oh, well, that doesn't apply really because he was speaking to a certain people. That's why gay people say, oh, well, that man on man doesn't really apply because that was speaking to. And then you could say, oh, well, drunkenness isn't really about me. You see, what does the Bible say? Do not give the devil a foothold. That's why Richie, a new believer, one day in the men's breakfast, he flat out, we were having a debate over something, and he just said out of nowhere, yo, it either says it or it doesn't. From a new believer, that was inspiring for me. Once you give the devil a foothold, your whole doctrine is going to fall. Once you say that doesn't apply to me, that applies to for that specific people, you're done. Paul is not speaking on his own accord. Paul is not going against the teachings of Jesus. Paul is not saying that the law is covered by grace. Paul is not saying that the law is covered by faith. That's what we were taught. Now we're living under grace. We're living under faith. If you have faith in God, that means you're obedient to God. If you're obedient to God, what are you obedient to? The standard of God. It just makes so much sense. It's so simple. So we finished chapter 5. Does anybody have a question? We finished chapter 5. Look at what it says in chapter 6. Paul knew that what he said in 5:20 was going to be taken out of context. Can you go to 5:20 real quick and then back to 6:1? But where sin abounded, grace abounded much more. Paul knew that we were going to screw it up, because look at what it says. Where sin abounded, grace abounded much more. That's what we're doing in the church. We're like, nah, we're under grace, bro. I love Jesus, man. Yo, I'll see you at the bar. Yo, I got a girlfriend in the church. We don't have to get married. I'm under grace. Yo, I'm living like this. I'm under the grace of God. Jesus Christ died on the sin. Then the Apostle Paul comes back in 6:1 to make sure that we don't get it twisted. And he says, what shall we say then? Let me tell you something. When God asks a question, he knows the answer. Right? He asked Adam, where are you? Like, come on, God. You know what's up, man. You know I shouldn't have done that. You know what I'm saying? He asked a question. So this, Paul's style of writing is called a diatribe. A diatribe is like a form of presenting a debate. That's why he's always asking questions. And the best example that I could think of, it may not be a good example, but the best one that I could think of, it's a man that says he loves his wife. But he's not living like it. So then a man stands in front of God, and he says, I love my wife. And God's like, oh, you love your wife? You love your wife even though you were at the bar yesterday? A question. That's called the diatribe. Oh, you love your wife even though you put your hands on her? Oh, you love your wife even though you neglect her? So if you neglect your wife, then what makes you think that you're a good husband? Paul writes like that in the book of Romans because he's debating with these philosophers. He's debating with these intelligent people. You know, the Greeks, we've all seen the cartoons with the leaf thing and the robe and all of these things, all of these philosophers. Basically, philosophy is your thoughts outside of Christ. Anybody's right. Socrates is right. Plato is right. In Christ, it's one mind. It's one mind. It's one spirit. It's one truth. There's only one truth. So Paul says, what shall we say then? It's like, I told you that grace abounds. What shall we say then? Shall we continue to sin so that there be more grace? He's basically telling them like, oh, so if God is going to give us grace, let's just really turn up the sin. So then that way we can have more grace. Yeah, that's what he's saying. Huh? Exactly. Like, it's so simple. It's so simple. Like, I'm so excited, huh? It is. And what Paul is saying is, like, he's using their natural intelligence. That's the church right now. That's called antinomianism. That's a belief that we are free from the moral law. And people say the Ten Commandments is different than the other laws. According to the Bible, it's not. Because in Ezekiel, when it talks about the new covenant, it says what Sister T's been saying, that the Holy Spirit will write, Ezekiel 26:36, please. That the Holy Spirit will, that God will take out your heart of stone, will give you a heart of flesh. He'll put your spirit in the heart of flesh so that you can live his statutes. And which statutes, commandments, ordinances, all of those, if you look up the definition in Hebrew, it's the same thing. 26:36. Ezekiel 26:26. Somebody praise God for me, please. Ezekiel 36:26. This is the new covenant. Let me know when it's up. That back TV is off. Look at what it says. This is the new covenant. You always hear people say, bro, we don't need the law. We don't need the law. Somebody said to me, you know, you Bible college students, you guys are putting people in bondage. You guys are putting a yoke around people because you guys are teaching people to follow the law. But if you look at somebody's life, the fruit speaks for itself. Where do you think you get spiritual fruit from? From because you have a Mercedes Benz? What is spiritual fruit? Because you have a happy marriage? Spiritual fruit, it comes from keeping the law. That's what spiritual fruit is. Look at what it says, and then I'll go to you, Sister Chantel. I will give you a new heart. This is what Sister T's been saying all night. I will give you a new heart. I will put a new spirit within you. I will take out your heart of stone out of your flesh and give you a new heart. Verse 27. I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes. So people say that the commandments of Moses are different than the statutes and different than the judgments and different than the ordinances, and it's not. If you look up the definition of statutes, if you look up the definition of judgments, and you look up the definition of ordinances, it all means a divine law. So it's all the same thing. But what I've shown the church, because it's very difficult to push this forward, I didn't receive it right away. That's why I just say the Ten Commandments. Because somebody raised their hand and tell me, what's wrong with the Ten Commandments? Which one of those do you really believe you shouldn't follow? You think it's okay to murder? Even in the book of Romans in chapter in chapter 2, it says that even people that don't know the law, the Gentiles, there's a natural law that is in them. In Romans 2, we went over that. That, Vladdy, even before you came to Christ, you knew right from wrong. Did you go 90 on the highway? No. Did you kill anybody? No. Did you steal? No. Even, yeah, let's stop. I'll take the last one back. You know what I'm saying? Everybody locking their doors. You get what I'm saying? So look at what it's saying. I will put my spirit within you. But why? Why did he give us the Holy Spirit? He says, I'm not even talking from my own mind. I will put my spirit within you. It's to cause you to walk. Faith without works is to walk in my statutes. And you will keep my judgments and do them. So then people go, oh no, well, that was written to the Hebrews. That's not written for us. You see what I'm saying? It's like, no, I'm going to sin no matter what, because that's what the Bible says. That's not what the Bible says. It's not what the Bible says, because we're going to read in Romans 11. That's why we need to all get on the same page as we go on to the next. When we finish one third, we're going to go into the second third. In Romans 11, it says that we're grafted into the olive tree. The olive tree is Israel. And it says, don't boast because you're a branch. That means we can't be like, yeah, that's right. We're not you guys. The Bible says in Romans 11, I'm paraphrasing. It says you're alive because of them. You're alive because of the root. So when people say, yeah, but that was written for the Hebrews and we're Gentiles, we're no longer Gentiles. When somebody receives Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, you're no longer a Gentile. A Gentile is somebody that is outside of the covenant. Once you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, according to Romans 11, you become grafted in. We become part of the Hebrew Israelites. That's why everything applies. God is not coming back for one church of the Dominicans and Puerto Ricans and the blacks and whites and then for the synagogue. He's coming back for one church. One church. That's why the Jews in Israel right now, you see that they put that little piece of paper in the wall. You see them praying on a wall. You know why they do that? Because the Messiah that they read about was right in front of them and they didn't even recognize it. Because the Messiah that was right in front of them was telling them that the kingdom that he was bringing is not the kingdom of this earth. That's what they wanted. The Hebrews wanted a kingdom of here. That's why you hear the jokes, and it's a little racist, but that's not my point. My point is just to connect something that we've always heard. What do we always hear about the Jews? Que son tacaño, right? That they're hard with money. So that came from because when they saw Jesus, they were like, yeah, we heard about the Messiah, kid. Yo, the Messiah came to, come on, yo, owe me the money. And Jesus was like, yo, my kingdom is not, I'm not even, like what you saying I came to give you, like it's, like I'm over here. And they were like, he ain't the Messiah, nothing. And Jesus like, you know what's funny, right? Because I know that I'm the Messiah. You know what's funny is that you read this law every night, but deep inside, you're dirty. So then the Pharisee was like, pero mira este. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? The person that they studied, the law, the standard of God was walking right in front of them that they studied. They knew all 613 laws. They knew it all, was standing right in front of them, and they didn't even recognize it. That's why. Exactly. Because that's why God is calling those 10 tribes, the 10 tribes are the Gentiles. Those 10 tribes that are scattered throughout the earth, those are the Gentiles. Everybody's mixed. Now when we come back into the fray, this is what it is. So how can we say that we're grafted in Romans 11, we're going to get there, and then think that we can live however we want? If you let me stay in your house because you feel bad for me and my family and I'm staying in your house, am I going to stay in your house and do whatever I want? No. Imagine you let me stay in your house and you wake up and I'm brushing my teeth in your sink in your bathroom. And I'm like, no, hello, good morning, I'm a guest. You're like, bro, I'm going to let you stay in my house, but do not come into my bedroom. Wouldn't, right? How can we then turn around and say to God, well, Jesus, I appreciate it, but I'm not going to change, man. Like, I'm staying like this. It doesn't make sense, right? Sis, you asked about the Sabbath, right? On the Sabbath day, what the Bible says, you are supposed to keep the Sabbath. What's wrong with the day of rest? You know why it's Sunday? Because the Roman Catholic changed it to sun to make up for the S-O-N, they made it S-U-N. We're supposed to have church on Saturday. We're supposed to have church every day, but we're supposed to have church on Saturday. Because that's what it means to keep the Sabbath. So what do we do now? Right? That's why it's on Sunday, because the Catholic Church said it. So what it says, and I'm glad that you came because I wanted to address that. It says that on Saturday, you're not supposed to work, right? Most of you know I'm a registered nurse. So on Saturday mornings, I used to do my patient charts. I used to wake up at 6 and I would work till like 10 doing my patient charts. Whatever you do for work, don't do it on a Saturday. So once this started becoming real, I stopped doing it on a Saturday. And it also says a holy convocation. You're supposed to be in the Word on Saturday from sun up to sundown. You're supposed to spend time with God. Is saying, yo, take one day for me and read and just read and just relax and just be in my presence. What is wrong with that? What's wrong with that? What we do on Sunday is really supposed to be on Saturday. Go ahead, Sister Chantel. It's on Saturday, but the Roman Catholic Church, they changed all this stuff that we've been taught about the Word and twisted it and made it on Sunday, because Sunday is like S-U-N. It's right, S-U-N for Sunday, right? It's the sun god, Apollos, right? So the Roman Catholic Church, they try to get us to get our mind off of anything related to Jesus, right? So that's why they worship Apollos. Apollos is the sun god, right? That's why you see Easter Sunday, right? Resurrection Sunday. That's why we go to church on Sunday. But Sunday is not the Shabbat. It's not Saturday. But it's the change. And that's what I'm finding are these little changes that the Roman Catholic did, even through scripture, that confuse the masses. That's why there's a lot of confusion. And in these last days, we all will be aligned. Spiritual fruit, love, joy, peace, understanding, self-control. If you pull up to me at a red light and you see me flipping somebody off and yelling at the top of my lungs, and then the next day I don't know that you saw me, and the next time I'm like, hey sis, God bless you, you're like, I saw this guy in a fit of rage. That's not self-control. That's why when you're hooked to cocaine, hooked to alcohol, hooked to sex, hooked to shopping, hooked to TV, hooked on laziness, there's no self-control. Hooked on food, there's no self-control. That's how you can know. And what's the Holy Spirit? The Holy Spirit and Jesus and the Father are the law. They're the standard. You understand? The Holy Spirit lives in us to be like Jesus. Jesus died so we can have the Holy Spirit. The Father sent the Son so that he can have a sacrifice. Jesus went into the grave so that he could be resurrected by the Holy Spirit. It's all so that we can come back to God in honor, honoring God. It's not following the law in a legalistic way. It's Paul is saying, not me. It's not me. Don't look to me. In the text, it's saying so that we can show honor to God. What is wrong with that? What is wrong with God? You cannot choose the way you love God. God determines how you love him. Like I said when I was preaching here a couple of weeks ago, and I was scared to preach that message because it was the first time that everything that I've learned in private that I said in a public forum, it's on Facebook. I didn't get any hate texts. So I passed the test. It was really God that showed me, right? But I was doing something with Eunice. I was bothering her, whatever. And Eunice said the Sunday before I preached, she was like, "Stop doing that because you know I don't like that." And I went, "That's what it is. That's the law. Like, if I'm gonna love my wife and I'm doing something that she doesn't like, she's like, yo, dude, I got a standard. I married you because you keep my standard. You know that I don't like that." So when I show up to Eunice and I start treating her like this, that's when we got issues. But when I treat Eunice to the standard that she has shown me to love her, so how can we then go to God and say, no, God, I mean, really, thank you for like everything, but I'm gonna love you the way that I want. That's religion. If religion, listen, if you wanna be a part of the kingdom, you gotta do what the king says. This is what the king says. If you don't do what the king says, that's religion. Religion is when you make something up. Religion is when you change your own standard. See, I forgot to say that. So that's, see, here's what I mean. Here's what I mean. Here's what I mean. It's incremental. It's incremental. I've been eating pernil my whole life. Like, I love ham and cheese. And you know what? My wife and I, we have come into agreement. I don't eat pork anymore. No, but it's, but there's grace though. There's grace for that. You see how grace works? It was God's grace. It was God's grace. I'm in a different spot from you guys because God took me somewhere deep into the scriptures. So now I love eating ham and cheese sandwiches. I ate a couple of weeks ago. We're on a 40-day fast. The brothers in the church haven't eaten for a minute, but I'll probably eat some ham right now. I ain't even gonna front. Forgive me, Lord. See, that was... Listen, because I know the service is over. See, that's rebellion. But look it. I went, once I made the determination, once I ate the last piece of ham, I went to Market Basket and I bought turkey. That's me showing God, like, yo. Well, not only that, but because in the standard of God says that it's an unclean animal. You see? Nah, that verse, I know, me too, sis. Praise God. Okay, that's what I believe. Here's what I'm going to tell you. Google wherever that is and read it. Here's the thing. If Paul says that, right? If Paul says, listen, I'm being serious. This is what I mean. This is what I mean. It has to fit. If you read something, for example, Paul says we can eat pork. I know. No, just let me go down this road. Okay? If Paul says that we can eat pork, and the standard says that the pig is an unclean animal, what does that mean? That means que algo no pega. So we have to stop at that moment. If you're like, wait a minute, it says this verse, because what we do is we take a little verse and we're like, I found it right here. But maybe you did, but that has to fit. It has to fit back where you found it. You understand what I'm saying? Let me say it a different way. If Paul says we can eat pork and God says in the Torah that it's an unclean animal, do not touch it, that means the Bible contradicts itself. The Bible cannot contradict itself. It does not. contradict itself. So when we read something like that, that means we have to go back. We have to take God's law and we have to take what Paul said and we have to figure that out. Paul never breaks the law. Yes, but it's the same thing because it's not two standards. If it is, it creates confusion. So that's what people say. That's what I kept saying to the teacher. Oh, no, that was for Moses. It's not. We just saw it in Ecclesiastes right here. This is what people say. People say that the statutes and the judgment are different than the commandments. But if you look up the word statutes, if you look up the word judgments, if you look up the word commandments, it all means, in so many words, a divine law. It's not, because that would create confusion. God did not create two standards. And that's what I was taught. The passage that Peter saw, pigs coming from the sky, and he said, you can eat it. It doesn't mean that. If you read it in its context, it doesn't mean that. It actually is a vision about the Gentiles, but I was taught that I could eat pork. That's what started this. That teacher came to my house and I was eating pork on the grill. And he said, you know, the Bible says we shouldn't eat that. And I said, well, it does, because it said Peter had a vision and he showed me. And that's not what it means. That's what I was taught. You have to remember, whatever it is that you believe, it has to fit everywhere. It has to fit. That's a matter of life and death. Okay. That whatever you decide, that's between you and God. That's between you and the Lord, man. I don't want you to be confused. I don't want you to be confused. The classes we're over, but I want everyone to leave with understanding this. God bless you. There's only one way to read the Bible. Whatever it is that you're confused, right? Read it. If it's justification, you have to put it away. Sometimes Paul, he's speaking about being justified. He's talking about being saved. So you have to put it in the proper category. Paul is not going to say to eat pork if the law says not to eat it. Does that make sense? Like, we have to agree that the Bible doesn't contradict itself, right? So when we find a contradiction, we have to study it more. Because if not, Jesus has his own teaching and Paul has his own teaching. That's why people misunderstand the epistles. That's where the antinomianism came from. Is people saying, nah, we're under grace, we're under faith, which is the same thing as saying, I'm saved by faith, therefore I never have to be concerned in the slightest thing about the law. It's a distortion in Christianity. Because the 613 laws don't apply to your life. No. The 613 laws, some of them are repeated, number one. Number two, not all of those are by man. Some of those are God's judgments and statutes. It's like saying, I want water, but then I say, give me a bottle. It's the same law, but man twisted it. Okay, hold on. So you have to attempt. That's where we make the mistake in Christianity, that we say, well, how can I do all of that? It's grace. You haven't even attempted it. We just sit there and we're like, no, I'm not even going to try it because it's impossible. But what is grace for? It's to try. We're saying, just because I can't do it, I'm never going to do it now. That's why there's so many denominations. That's why there's 30,000 denominations in Christianity. That's what I used to say. If you got to keep one, you got to keep them all. Not all of them apply. Not all of them apply to your life in the season that you're in. But the one that applies, like for me, for pork, and for my wife, I'm trying my hardest to move away from it. If I go to a party someday and I see the food there and I happen to grab a pork chop and eat it, God, I'm sorry, His grace is sufficient. But I gotta try. I can't just say, okay, let's. Well, because you're separating the Ten Commandments and you're separating the 613. That's problem number one. They're all the same. A commandment from God is a commandment from God. That's number one. You're saying like, well, there's this 10 and then there's this. There's not. There's only one standard. There's only one standard of God. Only one. And maybe, just like me, the reason why you have failed is because you're not leaning on the grace of God more and on the truth of God more, because it seems like man is telling you to do it. But when you realize that God is saying, I gave you my spirit so you can do it, it's different. Go ahead, sister. The other ones fall into place. You cover exactly. And some of those is what Brother Leonard said. Some of those are man twisted and came up with, because the Bible talks a lot in the New Testament. Jesus says, you follow the traditions of man. You wash your hands because, but the inside of the cup is dirty. So yes, there are traditions of men, and Jesus says it. But the traditions of men and the commandments of God are not the same. But it's true, because if you don't commit murder, then you're probably not sleeping with your neighbor's wife either. So the base of that, the base of what we're learning is the Ten Commandments. And if you can just start with those 10, you'll see that everything else will start to blossom out on its own. But another thing, if you think that the law is bad, you'll never want to fulfill it. Your spirit is going to be convicted now, because what was shown to me, I showed it to you, but you have to now research it in the text for yourself. And I'm telling you, it is liberating. It is liberating. I can finally read a commentary and find errors in a commentary because of what the Lord has shown me. Somebody used to, like Chantel, I used to look up, if you look up the law in articles, they always talk about justification. It's never sanctification. So somebody will go home and Google 10 articles and they'd be like, wow, the pastor really screwed up tonight because he went for an hour and a half saying, but look at these 10 articles. But if you really read that, it's about being saved. It's not about changing. It's not about sanctification. It's not about becoming like justification, and sanctification are two completely different things. Being sanctified, for me, I'm already saved through the blood of Jesus, through my faith alone and through grace. But now I'm sanctified because now I'm like, God, I'm going to make an attempt to, I'm not going to eat pork. Like, I'm ready. Help me. Help me do that. And show me grace when I fail. What's wrong with that? Does fall into place. And listen, that's what the Holy Spirit is for. The Holy Spirit is so you can do what God is asking you to do. When people go, I want to know what the will of God is. The will of God are the commandments of God. It's not a mystery what God's will is. We're like, man, what's the will of God in this situation? Bro, maybe stop. Exactly. All right, somebody want to close in prayer? Hold on a second. Can you go to Mark 7:6? Please. You have to read this on your own. It's liberating. It broke everything that I was taught. The Holy Spirit. Look at what it says. Jesus, look, this is one where people say that the law is bad, that we're tying a yoke around ourselves. He answered and said to them, this is Jesus in red letters. Well, did Isaiah prophesy of you hypocrites? Hypocrite means doing the opposite. As it is written, this people honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. Meaning they say that they're keeping the law, but they don't. Verse 7. And in vain they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men. Teaching as doctrines the commandments of men. That's why what Leonard said, that he said, oh, 613, they're all from men. That's what I was taught. That's what I thought. But it's that they're teaching as doctrines the commandments of men. Verse 8. For laying aside the commandment of God, laying aside the command. This is Jesus in red letters. If you're writing notes tonight, write down Mark 7. Because when I read this, this was a hammer to what I believe. Laying aside the commandment of God. Here's the commandment that we're supposed to keep. Jesus is saying, you lay aside the commandment of God, which means that we're supposed to have it. Do we agree? Are we in agreement there? Jesus said, you lay aside the commandment of God and you hold the tradition of men, the washing of pitchers and of cups and of many other things you such do, which is a good point that Brother Leonard said. Some of those commandments, they are twisted and they're duplicated right there. Verse 9. He said to them, all too well, you reject the commandment of God that you may keep your tradition. You see, we're rejecting the commandment of God to keep these silly traditions. Jesus never said that we're not supposed to keep the commandment of God. Paul said what Jesus said. Jesus said what the Father said. The Father said what his standard said. Amen? Amen. Brother Richie, close us out in prayer.